Hello, everyone. Welcome to Dancer from the Dance Festival of Irish Choreography 2021. I'm John Scott. I'm the director of Irish Modern Dance Theatre and of Dancer from the Dance Festival of Irish Choreography. I'm very, very happy you're all here. And I want to thank our sponsors, the Arts Council of Ireland, Dublin City Council, and our partners, the Centre Culturel Irlandais, Dance Limerick, Dance Ireland, Project Arts Centre, Irish Arts Centre, and Smock Alley Theatre. Tonight, we are starting with a panel discussion called Dancing Memory, which will be moderated by Dr. Aoife McGrath. But before then, I want to welcome our one of our most important partners, Sheila Creevey, the Chief Executive of Dance Ireland, to make a welcome welcome, Sheila. Thank you.
Hi, John. Thank you. I'm absolutely delighted to be here today. As most of you will know, Dance Ireland is the national representation and development organisation for dance in Ireland. We are very pleased to be partnering again with John Scott and Irish Modern Dance Theatre for this year's Dancer from the Dance Festival. I think you will agree it's a fantastic lineup, and I am so looking forward to the rest of the week. Partnership is central to how we work at Dance Ireland. It is important that we are building relationships, connections, and networks amongst artists and audiences for dance nationally and internationally. Central to this is acknowledging the relationships built by hardworking artists. And I would like to thank John for his generosity in sharing his networks, his contacts, his experiences for the benefit of all who love dance. Congratulations on a wonderful program, and I look forward to a great week of dancing ahead.
Thank you very much, Sheila. And now it's my great pleasure to hand you over to Dr. Aoife McGrath, who is going to moderate our panel on dancing memory. Thank you, Aoife. Welcome.
Thank you, John. Thank you, Sheila. Absolutely honoured to be moderating this panel. And it's the opening panel of the Dancer from the Dancer Dance Festival. Wherever you're tuning in from around the world, you are very welcome. And we hope that you enjoy our discussion. I'm currently in Dublin, and it's 5 o'clock in the evening, and it's still very bright outside. So whatever time of the day or night it is where you are, grab a comfortable seat and enjoy. So I'm going to introduce you to our stellar panelists, and we have 9 of them. So I'm not going to introduce using their full biographies because we would take up too much of our time. We have one strict hour that we have to keep to. But please do go to the festival programme for those of you who'd like more information about their collective brilliance, but you're going to get to know them now anyway. So in alphabetical order, here we go. We have Zoë Ashe-Browne, who's a professional dance artist and choreographer from Dublin. We have Sheila Creevey, who you just met, the CEO of Dance Ireland. We have Finola Cronin, who was a dancer in Wuppertal with Pina Bausch, and she's worked also with Vivian Newport and Raymond Hoch, and she's an emeritus assistant professor in drama studies at UCD. We have Oona Doherty, who's a dance artist and choreographer based in Northern Ireland and just recently won the 2021 Venice Biennale Silver Lion. We have Alexandre Iseli, who's a dancer and choreographer and who co-founded Tipperary's resident dance company, Iseli Chiodi Dance Company, with Jazmin Chiodi in 2009. We have Christine Kono-Pohlman, born in the United States, who has worked with George Balanchine, Martha Graham, Kazuko Hirabayashi, and Donna McHale, and who's still dancing and teaching, and most recently has been working with the Dance and Ensemble Berlin in Rabbi Murway's creation, You Should Have Seen Me Dancing Waltz. And we have Michael Seaver, who is a musician and writer and dance critic for the Irish Times. And then we have Junior Yusuf, a Nigerian-Irish performer, who is a freelance dance artist working between Ireland and Brussels. So we have just such an amazing lineup. welcome, everybody. I hope you're all very well. And let's start. We did a little bit of prior prep working on our title for this panel, which is Dancing Memory, Defining Identity Through Dance Performance and Creation. And it's such a rich title and such a rich topic, and we have so many voices to hear from. So I thought in the first instance that we would go to each panelist in turn and just hear their thoughts on the opening question of what does the phrase dancing memory mean to you? So it's a huge question. There's an awful lot to hear, and our different panelists will take us in a myriad of different directions with this question. But I'm going to start and ask Finola Cronin, would you mind kicking us off with your thoughts about this giant question?
Hello, everyone. I'm not sure you can hear me and see me.
I can hear and see you, Finola, perfectly.
Very good. So thanks, Aoife, for the introduction. And thanks to John and Aoife for organizing this topic for us in such an interesting way. And thanks, of course, to John for this wonderful festival. Thought-provoking is this, surely. I suppose with me, in terms of identity and dancing, I'll give you a very potted biog. I won't go on too long. I did leave Ireland to work in London and eventually ended up in Germany, working with Pina and with Vivian Newport. And for the most part, particularly working with Pina, that topic of as a dancer, who you were, where you came from, what you thought about, I think people might be familiar with Pina's ideas of, she was interested in dancers and not so much in how they moved, but in what moved them. And this was really something that was present every day in our rehearsals. And I would say every evening when we went on stage and so on, and our, you know, after show discussions, it was really that, you know, I was part of an ensemble that was hugely interested in what was happening in other people's worlds, to put it like that. And just to give you an example, in terms of how we worked when we were creating work with Pina, it was really about a research into our own archive, into our own identity, what was specific or unique about where we came from. And this was in a company when I was there that had a company of about 25 or 28 people with coming from about 14 or so different countries. So a huge array of diverse experiences of culture, of behaviors, of customs, of traditions, and so on. In an article I wrote, the title I pushed about this kind of work at that time for me was Creating Trans Theatre, Finding Ireland with Pina, because for me, the research into the work and into the making of theatre was really a research into my own biography, and specifically an excavation of my roots, where I came from. And you'll have to remember that this was, you know, I was working with Pina from 1985 for 10 years. And in that period, it's pre-internet. And, you know, places appeared to be very different and unknown to us. There was a lot to discover about each other's cultures and so on. And so I did spend my time, as Ninette de Valois, the founder of the Royal Ballet, mentioned, I was a hoarder of all matters Irish. I was really immersed so much while I was in Germany with my own, I suppose, memories of Ireland, my own family, my own, the traditions I knew, the folklore I knew, the literature and so on. So that's one aspect of how, while I was, and just that, in case you're not familiar with the way Pina would work, I'll just reference briefly that it was a very long process of dance making that was about tasks or aufgaben, where people had to bring ideas, all the dancers brought ideas in a very formal way to her table, if you like, and these were mulled over and then discarded or used and so on, and eventually brought together to make a work. So that's one aspect, I suppose, of the dancing memory and its relationship to identity that sort of, I suppose, spoke to me about the title. And very briefly, just to mention as well, I've gone back into dancing now because I've taken retirement from University College Dublin, and I've been recently working with a number of choreographers. And so I'm back from sitting, you know, moving from sitting behind a desk, I'm back in the studio, which is just terrific. But I'm also finding that business of meeting my body again to be really exhilarating. Difficult, challenging, very different to before, but I have these amazing moments of actually moving now, where it's really like experiencing things that I remember about my body that I had forgotten, that I hadn't actually practiced in a decade and a half, and that's, you know, part of, again, that idea of how the body remembers what is inscribed. But I notice that sometimes my memory fails me a bit when I'm trying to remember learning movement, which is kind of all things from embarrassing to, you know, frustrating and so on. But once I get sequences, I remember them again, and I won't lose it. So I was thinking again today earlier that I think perhaps my engagement with how I deal with movement and how I assess it, analyze it, and allow it be inscribed on my body is also changed, possibly by necessity. But it's that wonderful thing about memory that, you know, stretching and moving the body and making shape and form, and sometimes it feels like exactly like it did. I know it doesn't look exactly like it did at all from the outside, but from the inside, something is at peace and is very, very satisfying. So they're just two aspects of my response, Aoife, to the question, to that wonderfully open and complex question. Thank you.
You dealt with that beautifully, Finola. Thank you so much. What a rich answer. So it's fascinating. You've already outlined two of the really, really important aspects of when we think about this idea of dancing memory. So there's the, you know, the social and the cultural aspect of identity. And so fascinating that you had to go away to Germany to start, you know, having to be able to look back in any kind of objective fashion about your own identity as an Irish person. And then the second one, the somatic and the somatic identity and how your body is changing and responding differently as you go through your dance career. And it's just, I mean, for me, it's just such amazing and wonderful and brilliant news that you are continuing your dance career. I think for us, especially on the island of Ireland, we need that. We need to see people dancing professionally until they, yeah, until forever with no end. And I think that's just wonderful. So thank you, Finola. What a fabulous opening. We'll undoubtedly come back to you, and I'm going to bring in Christine. So Christine Kono-Pohlman.
Hi.
And there'll have been loads, I imagine there'll have been some parallels or some things that you recognized in what Finola was speaking about.
Of course, I had the luck to witness how Pina Bausch worked, because I was the ballet mistress for Pina from 1987 to 1994. And of course, it was amazing. Pina did bring out each dancer in such a way. Of course, they had to revert to their memories of their childhood and what was important in their cultural identity. But she brought out something that you would never expect. She brought out a surprise, a beautiful surprise about each person. And it was a kind of beauty that you never saw before in them. And I think they were surprised themselves. And this was the beautiful moment of her creative process that I loved, witnessing again and again and again. In the Lichtburg, where they rehearsed, but also on stage, there was this constant moving of the memory, so that the memory never stayed the same. it was always alive. It was not something static. And so each performance, when Pino was there, was very vital. It was never a repetition, never. And this is what's interesting for me about the identity of the artists who appear on stage. There has to be this vitality. It has to be happening at that moment, something. It's not just remembering choreography. It's taking, even if something is choreographed or something is scored or improvised, there's this vitality, something is happening at that moment that could never happen again. And this kind of energy is something that a great artist, director, creator can bring out of the participants in creation. And this is what's great. Of course, what Finola also mentioned, I mean, I still do perform myself. I am 74. And you, of course, your body remembers a lot. And what I discover is essentially you can move inside before, exactly like you did before, but the results, of course, are not the same. But that doesn't matter because your body, if you listen to it, it uses its memory to discover new ways of movement. Because as you age, your body changes. Right, actually every day it changes, so that you have the opportunity to discover all the time a new identity of yourself. And so this is what keeps you going, because you don't try to be the way you were when you were in your 20s, you know, but you try to discover a new identity every time you listen to your body. And this is what keeps, I think, and I hope everyone will continue. I noticed there are many young dancers in this panel that are brilliant and exciting. I've seen a lot of them on videos. Now I explored. And I would like to encourage everyone to continue, because it's always, it gives you a joy for life, dance. I think everyone should dance, actually, you know. I know that you work also with people like pregnant mothers or something like this. It's great. Everyone should dance. Everyone should dance, because it's. I think we all dance when we are really happy. Mm-hmm. And even if we express something that's sad, there's someplace deep inside of us, all of us, in our identity, something, a true joy that comes out through expressing ourselves through dance. And this is, I think everyone can have that. So that's all I can think about at this moment.
Christine, that was beautiful. Thank you. That was absolutely gorgeous. Again, such beautiful thoughts. So this idea that, you know, memory is not fixed, that we can be surprised by things what we knew about ourselves, and then we bring it into the studio, and, you know, with maybe with the facilitation, as you said, of a great artist or and choreographer like Bausch, you discover new things about your own memories.
And also the situation of the performance is great in your identity, because there you have to be super honest and at the same time, very, very aware of all your colleagues and the public, which gives another energy, which absolutely is a fantastic experience. In a big responsibility, at the same time, it's a very lively true experience. And you can feel it. We've all had this experience. It's not only on stage, it's where the public becomes part of everything. We're all part of the same and going for the same statement where our values join in life. That's the ideal situation. And we find courage. And we're inspired to continue. So let's continue. Yeah.
There's a really lovely link there that you've given me to our next speaker. You were saying that everyone should dance. And also the, you know, the work that we do together with the public. And that brings me very beautifully to Sheila, whose role now is to connect, deeply connected with both of those aspects of the of our discussion.
Absolutely. My internet is a little bit patchy today, so I apologize in advance if I break up. This is quite an amazing artist to follow. I feel very privileged to be on a panel with such depth of understanding. It's a great question, and I'm so delighted to have been asked that question in my role, because we don't often get asked this kind of question around dance, around memory, around that experience and the artistry of the form. So I had a thought, and I've got a couple of notes which I'm going to refer to, because there was so much I wanted to sort of keep myself sort of confined to where I needed to be. So you asked about the phrase dancing memory. I guess for me, it evokes a visceral response, recalling movements that I've felt and I've lived through performing, through learning, through being informed, and through imagining experiences. We often talk about dance as ephemeral, yet there are traces of dance, past dances remaining in all of us, whether this is as a muscle memory, a remembered time, a person, a place, or something that anchors us in a culture, an identity, and a sense of self. But if I was to take a more pragmatic sort of approach to that question about what dancing memory means, it could mean the act of representation, an embodied telling of our stories or those of others, which you've referred to just now as well, in terms of bringing people together. And in my role, inclusive representation is important. And I see my job as creating and holding space for artists and the art form. And in order to do this authentically, it's important to acknowledge and respect the legacy of artists, to understanding the lineage of the practice and ensuring those who embody their memories through technique, repertoire, inspiration, or indeed the total rejection of these, have what they need to develop their own artistic voices. And that's essentially, you know, what we try to do, you know, within development support resource organizations. Many of us have been dancers when many of us have sort of made decisions and sort of put ourselves in those in that position to support artists, because we believe in what they do. We are there because we have a passion for making the art happen, making dance happen. And I feel like contemporary practice is defined by inclusivity of style, influence, culture, and identity. And all of these have embodied memories of past and present dancers. And it's my responsibility and the responsibility of all of us who work in supporting roles for artists to listen and learn and respond with sensitivity, with empathy to the needs and wishes of artists. And we've all got a lot much more to learn from their experiences and the experiences of those who have gone before. So yes, the embodied memory of past dancing plays an important part, important role in my work and how I relate to the artist and the art form, but I still have my eye on the future.
That's fantastic, Sheila. Thank you so much. You're right. It is not often that we take the time to check in with the people in the roles, like such as yourself, who are behind the scenes supporting everyone to have these experiences, both the choreographers and the dance artists, the performers and the audience. So it's just a really interesting point and something to really, you know, that I'll think of in future as well, you know, for panels such as this, so we can start breaking down maybe some of those barriers we have as to, you know, who gets to speak to certain parts of what we do. So that was fantastic. And this brings us on very well to our next speaker, Junior. So Junior, we're moving from one spectrum of experience. So Finola and Christine having decades of experience, we're going back. You are, I'm not the biggest fan of emerging artists because I think a lot of people don't like that term. So I don't know if you consider yourself an emerging artist, but certainly not quite as many decades under the belt yet, yeah. But a really, really exciting artist and somebody that we've all got our eye on here and we're all really excited about. So what are your feelings about the dancing memory?
I think in this specific point in time, dancing memory has a lot to do with ancestral memories. And that's because I'm working on a solo at the moment. I'm researching and it's kind of touching on my own memories and my own archive and the memories and archive of my ancestors and the Yoruba people from Nigeria. And the cosmology of the Yoruba people. And so I'm kind of busy, I'm in that trip at the moment. So that has a lot to do, connect to dance memories for me. And I mean, it's a silly example, but growing up like in Europe, there was a lot of times I've heard or I've seen that, you know, people assume that because you're from Africa, you can dance. And for me in the beginning, I used to think, okay, this was a ridiculous stereotype. But then there was a point where I thought about it and I said, maybe there is some truth to it, you know, because the ancient African civilization, they didn't have written scriptures as we know them. So they were passing on their history through dance and it was passing on from generation to generation. And but for me, I didn't really learn any of these dances and I don't think my father did, so it didn't get passed down to me. But I sometimes question like how much of that information on my path and for my ancestors, it actually encoded into my body, my DNA somehow. And how do I tap into that memory, you know? And in my own like dance practice, I love improvising a lot. And I seem to notice that I have an affinity for sharp rhythmic movements. So I sometimes question how much of that is informed by this ancestral memory and these rhythms and dances from my ancestors. So I sometimes think memories also transcend the physical body or the individual experience, but also the collective, you know, like maybe my great, great, great grandfather could have, you know, experienced something that got passed down to the generations after him and then to me. So I just, I wonder if it's, And I also question, like, how do you embody these memories? So when I'm in the studio and I'm trying to, you know, of course I can watch the traditional dances on, you know, you can have access to them on YouTube and on the internet, and then you can learn them, but it's a different thing when you have to discover them in your body and you think how much of that, you know, have been passed down to you. So what is that physical memory and what is that ancestral memory? How do you tap into it? How do you embody it? And how do you allow yourself to be driven by it? And not just in your dance, but also in your physical daily activities, like, you know, your posture, how you carry yourself. You know, I suppose different people in different regions of the world carry themselves differently based on, you know, their cultural behaviors and so on. So I sometimes question how much of my ancestors' information has passed on into my body and how do I unlock it? How do I tap into it? How do I utilize it? How do I embrace it? And that's pretty much what it is for now.
That's great. You've touched on so many fascinating things there. So, you know, the idea of this ancestral body memory of these dances that even though, as you say yourself, it may not have been directly passed down to you, there's a sense that it's, you know, I'm going to be speaking here about something I don't know that much about, but, you know, epigenetic memory and all of this thing that where the idea that that it is in our genes, it is in our bodies, these memories can be passed down, even if we haven't, we don't seem to have done something ourselves, that they can be there in our muscles, in our tissues. Yeah, it's just so fascinating. And you're working on a piece at the moment that's tapping.
Yeah, I'm going to a bit of a research phase now and just collecting information. And I think it's really interesting how this question came about, you know, because I'm busy with this question almost daily, you know, like when I, apart from the dance, it's also the music, the stories and so on. And I left Nigeria when I was 9 and I hadn't returned back since. So I have my references and my connection are probably to music, to the story that I find online and the books and so on. But every now and then I question, is there a sense of familiarity? Like, you know, even if I didn't necessarily experience them, there is a sense of familiarity. And maybe it's not my memory, but it's the memory of my father or my grandfather. And I think I just find it so interesting how memory can kind of jump across planes of existence somehow. Like, it's not just right now, but, you know.
Yeah. What a fantastic thought. And that, thanks so much, Junior. We'll move along. I've got my eye on the time, and we'll move along to Zoë. And Zoë, it's so interesting. So, you know, this Yoruba dance tradition and the many kind of centuries of dance tradition that Junior's talking about. And I'm just thinking, you're working in another dance tradition, ballet, that also stretches back quite a way, not quite as far, but has you're working within a very specific tradition, but you're also working, I think you're moving into other realms of vocabulary as well, aren't you, in your own work? So how's it been for you? Because you've worked with some fascinating choreographers that are also quite interdisciplinary in a sense.
Mm-hmm. It's been really interesting, and it has not been a linear path. And funnily enough, I think because I'm from a really classical background, I definitely was trying to manifest that for myself. And it's so interesting listening to Finola and Christine about their experiences with Pina, because it's just incredible to hear her working practice and how she was all about defining what made her dancers individuals, makers, creators in their own right. She wanted to see the individuals. She wasn't clearly interested in emulating the night before. And so coming from a classical background, it's so different. And it's not to say that a classical background is a bad thing, but when I think about my approach as a young dancer, I certainly didn't have the most healthy relationship with my individualism or my identity as an Irish person. So I went to London when I was 16, and I went to the English National Ballet School. It was a great school, but I was the only Irish person there, and I spoke at the speed of light, and no one could understand me, and it was all very daunting. And I tried to stifle my individuality, I think, especially, it didn't occur to me that a lot of what made me who I was as an artist and how I expressed myself and how I engaged with the practice of classical ballet was about where I came from. But when I think back to it now, I definitely tried to not engage with that side of who I was, so that I could try to, you know, emulate my idea of perfection. And then going on to the conversation of cultural identity within dance and all of these kind of things, it's incredible to think of the classical world, because you really can tell oftentimes where someone has trained. Russia, England, even Spain, France, it's amazing how much influence comes from the culture or the schooling. And it's a really beautiful thing, actually. In terms of dancing memory and where I've gone now, so I work now at Opera Ballet Flanders. I work a lot with Sidi Larbi Shikawi, who really loves, actually, my Irishness, which is great. So I work a lot with creation, but also with repertoire. And so a lot is asked of me as a, you know, as a maker to contribute to an artistic process. And then of course I also create for myself, and I I need to engage with my body for all of that. And it's interesting because if I start the day off with a classical ballet class and it's very reminiscent of my training in school, and it's, I wouldn't want to say square, but it's, you know, formulaic, and in a way that I really, really remember, it's just kind of automatic. It's muscle memory. It's, you know, it's, yeah, it's, it tends to set me up in a certain way that then if I go into creation for the rest of the day, I feel like I have to destabilize everything that's hardwired. And so my creation that day will really be informed by my class. And so I try to, for at the moment, because I'm going from classical to contemporary, or I'm kind of in both mediums and I'm trying to find my way within that, I try not to do a classical class then if I'm doing a day of creation, because I can't, at the moment I can't touch it, because I have a, not a negative connotation, but I certainly myself yet I haven't found my my way to navigate how to bring that archive in and that memory in, and not get frustrated with myself and think, you're doing a passe, pirouette, stop. That's not what you want to do today. That's not what the plan was, you know, that kind of thing. It also, in terms of, you know, in my Irish identity, I've actually worked with the theme of emigration for years now, with my choreographic practice, because it was only when I went to Germany that I realized how homesick I was, actually. I really, really missed home. And there was so much that I was so grateful for. You know, I was so grateful when I lived in Germany, I was so grateful that I had left home, because I was able to see it, like Finola said, I was able to see it objectively for the very first time. And that has brought in so much to my creation. So it touches on so many different things: change, cultural barriers, languages, and how all of that informs your body. So yeah, I'm very grateful. I'm very grateful for my path, and I love this conversation. It's such a huge question, but I hope that's been a nice contribution.
That was fantastic, Zoë. Thank you so much. And again, it's such a rich answer. So you've touched on so many threads and brought them together very beautifully there in what you shared with us. And I'm going to move now to Michael Seaver. So Michael, you're coming at this question from a different perspective if we think about it in a dance context, perhaps, because as a dance critic, you know, you have to position yourself a little bit past the somatic, but maybe not. Maybe your embodied experience is present as well. But just to say that you're also a performer in your own right, and you're a very, you know, an extremely experienced musician. So of course you connect with all of these things, I'm sure, from a musician's perspective as well.
Yeah, absolutely. But I have to say, having listened to the great contribution so far from, you know, individual dancers with such a range of experience, I think they're kind of far better equipped to kind of to articulate that. I mean, I think for me, one thing that's of interest is this whole notion of a collective memory. And that's one thing that, you know, through when I first started, you know, being involved in dance in the 1980s, there was no real sense of a kind of a history of dance. I mean, like, the history of dance was basically it ended after Nanette de Valois left the Abbey and then started again when Joseph Denise Moriarty set up Irish National Ballet. And, you know, thankfully people like Vicky O'Brien's work on the Abbey dancers and Deirdre Mulrooney on Arena Brady have kind of begun to fill in some of those gaps. And, you know, there's one thing that there's always been this sense that the history of dance is the history of individuals. And that was almost seen as a criticism that, you know, these individual threads of practice weren't enough. You know, there wasn't enough meat there to create a history. But in actual fact, I mean, the history, a collective memory like that is rooted in the individual. And I think that, you know, another thing that has just been interesting, Zoë mentioning repertoire, is the other trait. There's never really been a repertory company in Ireland. There's always been, you know, companies have, I don't know if it's the funding structure or what, but there's always been the sense of creating a new rather than kind of looking back and remounting pieces. There are some companies who've done it, but never, you know, that sense of that, you know, traditional repertory company that kind of hangs on to the repertory and, you know, 10 years later puts on a work again. I suppose the one thing as collections of individuals, I think that dance has been in a better position to go against kind of accepted histories. I mean, if Susan Sontag says, you know, that the collective memory is it's not a remembering, but it's a stipulation. It's saying this is how things were. And, you know, I was thinking back to the pieces that were done in 2016 around the anniversary of the 1916 Rising, and you had the Embodied and the GPO, you had Fergus O'Cahor's Casement Project, you had Anu's These Rooms, and they were all really shaking off the, you know, the meta narrative and looking at individuals and telling the stories of individuals. And I think that's something that, you know, dance is a unique position to do. And I suppose the other thought I kind of had was, you know, we're talking about, you know, embodied histories. And I think back to a project that Emma Meehan did, where she remounted Lunar Parables, a work by Dublin City Dance Theatre. And it was interesting. I remember talking to some of the choreographers at the time, Mary Noonan and John Davis. And, you know, first of all, it was interesting that in recreating the pieces, Emma went back to, you know, videos, posters, programs, even reviews, and, you know, interviews to kind of create a more holistic idea of the piece. And it was interesting that in the gaps that individual dance choreographers had in their memory, armed with all this other stuff, they were able to not only potentially fill in the gap, but also just re-engage with this core concept of the piece and completely re-enliven it. And off the top of my head, I can't remember if it was Joan Davis or Mary Noonan, at one stage saying they weren't happy with a piece at the time. It was based around a spiral, but in all the practice that they had done since then, they went back to the piece and they were able to, you know, more successfully create it. And it kind of goes back to what, you know, Finola was saying, you know, that somatic identity changing through time and how you can kind of re-engage with old work with that knowledge. So it's kind of interesting in that, you know, should we always trust the body's memory, or do we is it that paramount? Are there different ways that we can kind of re-engage? And almost how is the act of forgetting as important as the act of remembering a piece in terms of looking at it over time?
Fantastic, Michael. Thank you so much. Yes, I saw that the Emma's project and the restaging of some of Lunar Parables. It was remarkable, and remarkable for that reason as well that you highlight, that it just showed what richness we are missing in our collective dance history here, that we don't have that opportunity to go back and revisit. And for new generations to come and tackle questions that were raised by earlier generations, you know, there's just such a wealth of work that we have to do to get to that point still. But it's very, very interestingly, moving to our next speaker, Oona. I wonder, are you okay to speak yet, Oona?
Hello.
Hi.
I might just move while I'm chatting, because if I move... My baby doesn't shout so loud, so I'm going to just keep
perfect. You keep moving, and we don't mind a bit of shouting. That is absolutely no problem. They will all count as perfect contributions.
Big memories, man. Yeah.
That's it. So So just connecting with Michael's thought, of course, it brings me to your experience. So, you know, we are often in on the island of Ireland and probably other countries as well, that, you know, things are that the funding is can be so scarce that we see a performance once and it's gone. You know, it has a run and it's gone, or it has, you know, it might tour a little bit and then it's gone. And because we don't have a rep company structure, we often don't get to revisit things. But you and your work has caused the imagination of people, you know, beyond Ireland, beyond Northern Ireland, beyond Ireland, beyond the boundaries of Ireland, and is being re-performed again and again. And you
keep out of it for sure.
So there is a Doherty, you know, rep company that is moving around. And so what is that work like? Because I know we've spoken about this previously. So there is work that you had created as a solo for yourself. And then it has, you know, for future iterations, you've had to hand it over to somebody else. So what's that been like? How does memory work there?
Yeah, that's cool. That's like the whole point. It made me think of what Finola and Christine were saying about the somatic memory, body changing. I made a little note when they were saying, because when you're doing a show on repeat on and on and on and you're on tour, like say in the premiere, there's a bit in the choreography where you have a cry. So in the premiere, you had a cry about your dad or whatever. 2 months down the line, that's not going to work anymore. You know, you're going to start faking it. So to be able to get the emotion still always present in the choreography, you need to take from different sources. And sometimes that's consciously thinking about other things like an actor would. And sometimes if you just really concentrate on your knee, something comes out, you know, or you just really do a back bend. You're like, Jesus, there was joy in there, or there was a bit of pain in there. So I found like doing tours for a long time helps you do that because the structure stays the same and then you can just keep living in it. But and then for teaching it to other people, you realize that you can teach one level, but then they have to go on tour for a long time to get that amount of depth in it. So you give them the surface narrative that they can go and ride, like maybe get one tour out of that narrative, and then they're going to have to bring their own troubles on the stage with them, I guess. If that makes sense.
Yeah, that makes
some more stuff.
Would you like to?
What was it? I was just going to say something about what Junior was saying, because I was like, yes, man, whatever he was saying about ancient dragging up the bloodlines, because sometimes I don't know whether to say about this. Hey, Bujija, I don't know whether to say about this because you feel like can be a bit hippy dippy to say stuff because it's not so scientific. But I really, when we did Magma, even if you're using it for an intent, you know, to get like the dynamic out of the movement or whatever, but I would really. And it's different from Junior's thing about like Nigeria and he left and how much of Nigeria did he bring with him. But when we were doing Magma, we would really try and dance with ghosts, like your granny's granny, 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 granny. Why was your great, 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 great granny raging? That's for her kind of thing. And even if it's not true, it just gives you like the power to do it. You know, it gives an extra dynamic in the movement, I guess, or the performer. I don't know what else to say now, lads. Everyone said amazing stuff. It's like a big, you need a week to go through this because there's so many levels of it, the technical side of it, but then the whole spiritual, you're touching the cosmos vibe as well, right?
Yes, that was gorgeous, Oona, thank you. That was perfect. And thank you, Rosario, for your beautiful vocal contributions there as well.
Oh, you could hear me okay. All right.
Oh, yeah, perfectly. Perfectly, Oona. Thank you. And now we'll move to Alexandre. And you, Alexandre, thank you, first of all, for your patience in being the very last person to come to. So I really appreciate it. Thank you so much. And as Oona said, so many things have been spoken about, but I think I've seen your work, Alexandra, and your wonderful work. And also you've been doing such incredible work in encouraging young choreographers and in nurturing the next generation of choreographers, and all that fabulous work you've been doing in broadening young choreographers' horizons. So you've got two hats that I'd like you to to speak to, your own as an artist, and then also that amazing work you're doing in preparing the next generation.
Yeah, that's very broad. I'm very nervous now. There's so many different things and elements. And I had different ideas, different elements I was thinking about. And I think I'm always kind of thinking, and I think we're working on this now, on how those two aspects reconcile. Like, can you be an organizer and then creating work at the same time? And where's the link? What's the coherence in that? And I was thinking, like, in terms of memory, I don't think I could dance anything else than my memory as a dancer, because I think that's what really I'm made of. So, and then when I work with other people, so that's the first step in getting away from myself, is I think I'm always searching. I call that, I didn't invent that. A teacher of mine said that one day. He said, I'm fishing for miracles. And he was a somatics teacher. And I think I've been doing that ever since. When I work with somebody, I'm fishing for miracles. So I throw lines, and what I'm trying to find is almost probably always a sparkle of memory. Because I think I'm looking for a sparkle of emotion to be shared. And I think I get emotion only if that person feels emotion. And when I say emotion, I don't... I'm not sure I have the right words in English, but I suppose almost like sub-emotions, they can be very tiny. Just what I might call sensations, you know? Mm. And I was thinking, if I'm trying to imagine what I perceive emotion is for me, I think an emotion is when something rubs against the memory. It's like something happens that touches some tiny, sometimes it's a tiny speckle of memory inside me, and that generates that little feeling, that emotion. And I think that's what I try to get a dancer to find when I'm trying to improvise, and I say, oh, that moment, that something happened there. So I'd say in that way, most of the work I've tried to do is embedded in that idea of emotion, really. I think it's quite essential, like actually essential is kind of the essence of the things I'm working on. And then another step further, if I think more as trying to give opportunities to other people, and more we're developing our work at Tipu Dance Platform as and I think you might try to see that vocabulary come out in the public as giving people a voice. Mm-hmm. And I suppose to give people a voice is to give a voice to that diversity of tiny emotions, those sort of sparkles of emotions, you know, that happen, and that gives the many different aspects of what we are. And, you know, it's a very complex mosaic, and it's very incoherent. Another sort of landmark thing that somebody, I was in a group and we met this theater person, and he said, I lost track of what I was trying to say. how can I say that? There's something about, we're trying to rationalize, even we're trying to reconstruct our own narrative, our own memory. And I think he said a phrase like, the way we use rationality, and I'm a very rational person. I was actually initially trained as a scientist, and I'm extremely rational. But he said that phrase, and I thought it was striking, really useful, that rationality, sort of the way we've used that has started to kill all the possible non-determination, is that a word in English? The sort of diversity of non-coherent elements that we have inside of us then that do constitute us. And so we're made of all those very complex little elements, and some seem to be very contradictory with each other. And somehow they're still ourselves. And all, it's almost like if you dance and you get those speckles of memories of emotion, you sort of acknowledge, this is me, and this is also me, and this is also me. And when somebody just creates that gesture or finds that tiny voice, and maybe it changes tomorrow, and maybe it changes 1 hour after, but that, at that moment, it's genuine. So it's really touching. It's touching that person, and it's touching, if it's touching that person, it's also touching the person who's looking at that person. And I think that's maybe the where I'm trying to go, either as a choreographer or when I try to create opportunities or give context for people to find their own voice or do their own work, that they can acknowledge and find those voices in their, even as small, and even if they're changing all the time. Yeah.
That's wonderful. Thank you, Alexander. You very interestingly threaded all the way back to the beginning of our conversation, very close to the beginning. So such an interesting parallel with Christine talking about surprises and thinking about how, you know, we can, that you can be surprised by yourself. And I love this idea of incoherence and allowing for things not to be determined, and, you know, creating that openness, letting messiness in, even though we are, as you say, very much, you know, I suppose we work in a very rational world in this post-capitalist neoliberal society, you know, to allow for those little sparks of emotion, just to, so we can recognize them, so we can be in a space where we can recognize those and get that sensation and then share that sensation in the moment. And then, as you say, tomorrow it could be different again. But that's the magic, right? What did you say? Fishing for miracles. I love it.
Fishing for miracles. And I think that possibility is maybe one of the root places where we can welcome diversity, really. That's where it starts, maybe.
Yes.
So it's take a rational topic that tends to come a bit top down, you know, policy guided. I think that's a place where I can really start tiny with that. And it's like acknowledging the diversity of myself. Sort of, I thought it was this and now it's that.
Exactly. I'm looking at the time, and miraculously, if I was fishing for a miracle that we would finish on time, it is 6 o'clock on the button. I don't know how our organizers think about questions from our audience. I'm not sure if we have time. We can finish very neatly now if you like, or we can take one or two questions, whatever you guys think, John and Pierce.
Thank you, Aoife, and thank you everyone for your amazing contributions. I wish we could keep this going, and I think possibly we are on a very tight schedule because Terry O'Connor is waiting in New York on a very tight schedule to give his talk back following Bleed. So if anyone has any questions or comments they would like to make, I think put them into the chat in YouTube and Facebook, and Catherine will collect these, and I'll diffuse these to all of you over the next few days, and we'll maybe be able to make a response. So thank you for an amazing discussion, and Aoife for wonderful moderating. I want to also thank the people who are organizing the festival, without whom it wouldn't happen. Greta Burke, the company manager of IMDT, and Catherine Reller, our production director, and Pierce Redmond, who's doing all the streaming on the internet. The amazing Luca Truffarelli, filmmaker, who's edited all the programs. And Conleth Teven, our PR, and Leontine, our assistant from France, who's been doing great work. So thank you to all of you. And we are now going to move to Terry O'Connor's Bleed, which will be followed by a discussion moderated by Laura Uprichard with Terry O'Connor. Thank you again, everyone, for this. And stay with us for the week. There is a performance every day at 6 p.m. And at 7:30 p.m. we have our gatherings every night. Thank you very much.
Bye.
We really appreciate you supporting tonight's performance. If you would like to consider making a donation, we're going to show a QR code which you can access with your smartphone and make a donation to support the work of the artists for Dancer from the Dance Festival. Alternately, you can make a donation by going to irishmoderndancetheatre.com and clicking the donate button. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. This is John Scott again, and thank you for being with us to watch The Stunning Bleed by Tere O'Connor. And it's my great honor now to Tere O'Connor and Laura Uprichard, who are going to talk about Bleed. And Tere, Laurie, it's over to you. And Tere, thank you for a stunning, stunning, beautiful piece. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, John. Hey, Tere.
Hey.
God, it was so great to see that. I felt like I was seeing an old friend, you know? Yeah. Like, oh, I remember this. I remember why I loved you. So we only have till 8 o'clock in Irish time. So I'm gonna start in. I hope we can get to some audience questions, but I'm not sure we will. So let's just get going. I have a couple of questions first.
Okay.
to start with, the building blocks. You know, as you wrote in your note, Bleed is a result of what you call collapsing three previous works into Bleed. They were Secret Mary, Poem, and Sister. And they were a quartet, a quintet, and a duet, I think.
Yes.
Is that right? Mm-hmm. Okay. But so they have different source material, completely separate casts, and then all 11 cast members are in this.
Yes.
For the creation process, which I think spanned 2 years, did you have this all planned out in advance to go through these stages? And if so, did it change very much from your initial plan till you got to the final version of Bleed?
Mm-hmm. Okay, the initial plan was always to collapse works together, because I think the basic way I've been working since I started was to do, you know, research in the form by trying to extract meaning from what I consider its elemental kind of engines of communication. And one of those is forgetting and remembering, and remembering incorrectly and replacing it and bringing one's own projections into it. And so I thought, well, what if I create a value system where that's more important than what we do normally with language, which is to take difficult multiple thoughts and reduce them into something that's deliverable. So it's a place to go that is both an elevation of one of these communicative motors, and also it's a kind of queer space of code switching and of differentiation and multiple thoughts coexisting at one time.
Which is kind of how your brain works, right?
Exactly. That's something, yes, I've often thought that, you know, the criticisms of dance, or often the way that dance critics write, or even some choreographers, are trying to find a kind of cogency that belongs to language and foist it on dance when dance isn't necessarily requesting that. So I try to use what there is in dance as a fundamental kind of tool. And then that extrapolates out to like ideas that are in the world also, of, you know, thinking that isn't, you know, like right now we're going through the worst time ever of, you know, binary attitudes, like either this or that. And, you know, choreography, being in the room with it, it's constantly diffusing your certainties, which is very important. You know, a certainty is like a disease at this point, and it's definitely a weapon, you know.
Oh, that's interesting. For those who haven't had the chance to see the other three works, how would you say that we might see echoes of them in Bleed? I mean, there's so much contrast. And this is what I remember taking with me through the journey, is sort of the contrasts of awkwardness and elegance, or chaos and order, or the industrial versus the lyrical, or but there's always a kind of sense of community, you know, whether people are working together or working at odds, there was always a sense of community. But would there be specific, I guess, vocabulary or framings of anything that would be reminiscent?
Mm-hmm. That's a good question. I think there were different things I was trying to do in poem, for example, was to look at what I always thought of in the structure of poems and in dance, some similarity, which is basically a recontextualization of meaning, a constant replacing of where things should be in different places. That's where I started from. And with Secret Mary, I started from absolutely nothing. The first day for that rehearsal was I said, okay, you guys are going to perform. It's a 30-minute piece. Just perform it now. And they did that. And then we started to take it apart and dissect it and analyze what the parts were and then rebuild it again and do another version of it and take it apart over and over and over again. And then I kind of extracted a structure from that. So I was looking at at what I would call positive undoing, what is just constantly happening as a choreographer. It's like building a house of cards in a tornado, you know, it just is always falling apart, you know. And Sister was one more of a kind of area where I've always used family references, sister, mother. I've made a lot of these things, and they're not necessarily literal for me, they're about relationships. And sister is basically the most benevolent of places for me and the most nuanced of voices. So I was really, really using like hyper subtle rhythmic polyrhythms and stuff in this work. In the footwork, there's a lot of really minute little pickety footwork in it, and using that as a specific kind of language that I was looking at trying to develop. All of those reside in Bleed. But other things do too. I mean, often I think there's like there's three things can come together to make a fourth thought. And that's the idea of collapsing for me, is that when, you know, for example, three people with their certitudes come together, if they're able to listen, there's probably a fourth idea that's better than any of them that includes them somehow and offers a newness to it. So there's that's what the whole Bleed was for me. Once I started to see that I put these things in a kind of, you know, a blender of some sort, then you start to see one little object before it gets completely minced, and you can pull that out. There's certain things you can pull out and they live in the kind of the miasma of the whole thing. But they are again, resituated from their original form. And their goal is not to spark memory. Their goal is just the coexistence with the present kind of constellation of ideas.
Yeah, I was going to say, you never get to a puree from that blender. The clarity of each moment is kind of astounding to me. Even having seen the piece a few times, things pop out. It's beautiful. And then they change completely.
Yeah. I don't know why it is, but I'm very, very thrilled with, it happens in life so many times. Like, you know, say you see, you go to a store and see one design by Dries Van Noten or some amazing person. You just see it for a second and then you go away. But later that day, you're still hit by what it was. You don't get to spend a lot of time with it. But that doesn't mean it didn't require exactitude in the making. And that's something I really think is very important, that I think, again, many choreographers and many people are desirous of a very amiable presentation of a sign system in choreography. And I'm not interested in that in any way. I'm interested in a kind of deep, deep commitment to complication and to complexity, which are kind of two different things. For me, in particularly, the artisanal on earth is something that is undervalued and that we walk by with a wink and it's anonymously made. That whole idea of like all this excellence, you know. I mean, I always think about going to Mexico and going to the market. I'm into cooking and seeing what these people are doing down there. And it's like, it's so vast. Yet some people are like, yummy, let's go away. You know, I mean, it's just, it's, there's so much depth to it. So I've always used this concept called everythingness in my work, and that there should be no themes. It's just a kind of immersion in everything.
Yeah, I think what I love though is you're not going from A to B to C to D in any way. You're just, you're going all over, but there's such a logic in it that I never feel lost. I always feel like you can find yourself there. And I think that's a structure, the structuralist in you.
Yeah, I think that there's, because I've been able to have enough time and been given enough like support and validation to keep doing work. I've been able to notice that there are structures that are non-canonic. There are structures that are just structures of the imagination that can be really valid if you do the work to kind of find them, identify them, and really build them. So kind of, you know, in this piece especially, the idea of ephemera as just something that's wisping around, I was like, no, I want to grab ephemera by the neck and shape things with it. So you could build a scaffolding of qualities, this quality to this quality, that's so strong that the visual information is kind of erased because the subterranean structure is kind of more present. You know, like people standing on a pedestal at the end of the Olympics. This person is over this person. It doesn't matter if this person is a serial murderer and this person, you know, like babysits kittens. This person's winning because of the structure of the thing. So, I mean, that's a simplistic way of looking at it. But in these kind of like unknown and what I call unviable structures that couldn't be... couldn't work anywhere else. They can work inside of a dance.
I also remark to myself often about the sense of humor that you have. I mean, there are laugh out loud moments, but there are also just like internal chuckles about how things develop or crash into each other or whatever.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think, you know, humor is a very big thing for me, but it's hard to create humor, but it's really interesting to allow for it when these incidences of collision happen, you know, not just necessarily physical, but like to, you know, I think there's a section where the men are doing this very serious kind of Gregorian based super gay quartet. And then suddenly the women come in like, what are you doing? You know, the people start walking in like they've been caught. There's something about it that you could really project a lot of humor onto. Or in, you know, in another way.
Walk in on half point and then flat, like they've got one high heel on. So it's funny in that.
There's also that. Yeah. I mean, I think that's something that I saw happening. I said, I could definitely bring it into another level by doing something like that. So, you know, the structure sometimes speaks to me and then I'll take a step from there also, you know. But yeah, the humor thing, I mean, basically, this is really banal, but in a Chekhovian way, you know, you don't never ever know where the humor and the seriousness reside. They're both kind of there and available.
So... having seen the work live and feeling rather lucky at this moment, mm-hmm. I did find that the film, which OTB on the boards did beautifully, it does give you some different information and different perspectives on the work.
Yeah.
But then of course you lose the extraordinary energy of those dancers being in front of you. I mean, especially the circling running when Heather just
goes crazy. Yeah, it's beautiful.
Yeah. It's always, you know, such a visceral moment when you're watching it.
Yeah.
But you could really see everybody's looks and how specific they were.
Yeah.
In a way that I don't think I remember them quite as clearly on live. But the layering's still very clear. And I wondered if you were happy with people seeing it as a film, or would you prefer, if they could, to see the live version?
I prefer it to be live, definitely. I mean, I think one of the great accomplishments in my life was to let go of my control and let them edit it. I let them do the edit. And I mean, I looked at a couple of, you know, like draft edits, but I think I was really busy doing something else. And I just was like, doing an edit of something like that is absolutely horrifying. And it takes your whole life up. Or if you're relaxed and not like me, maybe not, but for me it does. So I let that go. But no, it was made, you know, I think there's right now we're watching a lot of pieces that were made for the stage and then they become films. And I'm like, I'm very engaged in film history. Those aren't films. And this isn't really a film. It was a film made of a live event. So that's what it is to me. Although I do think it's really, I think sometimes in my work, the dancers, I mean, the kind of labor that's in my work, it is very difficult what they're doing. And there are a million micro cues that aren't coming from someone saying something that you just have to know. And it's very complex. I think what I really like about Bleed, and it's nice in this film, is that when they're standing there, they're kind of representing viewership like you. And they're saying, like, I have to be very concentrated here. This is not a picnic we're at. And then they enact it seconds later. So there's something about that I think is really much more engaging in here. And again, like I say, I mean, the amount of different kinds of dance that get incorporated, not even fully quoted, but just kind of pasted together, and the aptitudes with rhythm and everything, you know, and just like in and out of real presentation to fake presentation to just the self, that's all choreographed. And, you know, they're just amazing. So you get to see that a lot here, I think.
Yeah, I agree with you. And when they do stand still, they're very, I found them very watchable. You know, my eye was drawn to several of them in those moments.
They're very activated. We really spoke about that. You don't die in those moments. You're like buzzing, you know. So, and yeah.
We do have a question in the chat.
Okay.
a student of life asked if you could speak more about the genesis of your comfort in expressing the positive undoing. Finding beauty not only in the construction, but in the destruction is so powerful.
Mm-hmm. I don't necessarily think that I put the kind of value systems on beauty that this person seems to be offering. I also, one of the things, again, and I feel like I've been very blessed with a lot of support in my life to do this, but since I kind of realized that, you know, I've reached a very, very paltry top of this business. So there's no big profit available. So I thought, well, why don't I just do what I fucking want to do here? And that means to work outside of a good, bad paradigm, which I've been doing for years. I'm not going in the room to say, like, what's the best thing I can show that Terry O'Connor can do? I'm always saying, like, what the hell does dance do? And sometimes it makes these huge, incalculable messes that you kind of have to hold the whole thing, you know? And that's a central drama to me of this form, is this futility of being a choreographer trying to shape anything. You know, it's a huge active metaphor. But so for me, then there were things like where in this process of allowing this to be, as the questioner asks, I remember there being points where I, you know, like the juxtaposition of differences that happens in my work. I used to think, well, I'll go in one day and make something, and then I'll go in another day and make something. How do these come together? How can I make them develop? I'm like, you don't. They're just next to each other in your brain. In your brain, if you're thinking about a bill you have to pay, an abusive childhood, you're not like, how do those come into each other? They're just up against each other, you know? And so that kind of underworld and that kind of presence of the brain, like you said before, I'm trying to really ride that train, you know, and use that to shape things. Then I come in and shape it from the outside, but hopefully having pulled an organizing principle from the experience of making it somehow.
Right. So I'm not sure if there are other questions, Catherine. Here's one. This is a good one. Tere, can you talk about the vocal work? How did the vocal material arise? It's beautiful to have dancers sing and vocalize.
Yes. Well, there's kind of a humor around Oisin's presence because he's, you know, both angelic and a sassy, intelligent dude. And I really want, I mean, most, I'm really trying to include their personalities in the making of the piece. And in another work, Cover Girl, we made a score out of all the men singing. We had the men in the company go into, with James Baker, my composer, collaborator, we went into the studio and had them just sing a cappella and make fake love songs that had the word flower in it and all these kind of things. And we had a lot of material, but Oisin emerged as quite a singer. And so I just was thinking, like, you know, sometimes I'm pouring like angel sauce on him and sometimes more kind of like darker sauce when I'm using him in the work. And I thought, like, let's pull the angel up. So when he's there as this kind of ersatz kind of, you know, Trojan warrior or something after he's been dead and risen again. And then he goes into this angelic tone. I just think it's really very loaded all around the place and really rife for projection onto. And all of the, any vocalization in there, it just comes as a little bit of an extension of whatever's going on choreographically somehow. So that's what I would say about it.
Some of the vocals sound very Georgian. Are they, or is that James's version of Georgian?
James is a like music historian, and those are based on Baroque concepts of harmony, but it's a brand new thing that he made up, and it's all James singing. The male thing, it's all James. I know it is very, it's another thing that just gets overlooked in the work is his brilliance, you know. And the other, another voice in there is Mary Reed, one of the tall woman in there. She dances with Devin at the end. Her sister is a beautiful singer, and her sister is the rest of the singing on it, Mary.
Yeah, right, that's right.
I really love having voices that are part of the community of the making in the work. I've had like Heather has sung and Rob Besser, all people have sung on the material before because it just gives it some special atmosphere that you know they're from the kind of propinquity, as it were, my favorite word.
Okay. Ten star word. We have a question that asks if you could talk about the casting. How you put such an interesting group of human beings together. And also, is Oisin Irish? And that I will say yes to that one.
Yes, Oisin is Irish. He's Irish from Ireland, but he grew up in Long Island. I think he spent up until he was 8 or something. And now he's very engaged with his Irish history and life and has taught me great things about it because I'm less knowledgeable about my own. Yes, he is. And the way that I cast this is being blessed by having interesting people around me. And I also, I don't know if it's a good thing or a bad thing. It seems like a good thing. I really need to have people around me who I can be friends with and who dancers who see themselves as peers, not people who are being tortured by the choreographer. That whole psychology, and these people, many of these people make their own work. They're really engaged at the level of discussing the work. They're critical of it. They contribute, you know, and then also don't when they need not to, you know. They're really amazing cultural beings and also just friends. They're really, all of these people I know quite well, except for Mary, but we became friends really quickly. And I'm very into having a tight group. You know, we have to tour, we toured with this piece quite a bit, and you don't want to tour with a bummer person on tour, you know? So, and all of these people are just really clear about what they're doing as dance artists. No one's there as just like gonna go audition for anything I can get, you know. They have an aesthetic focus, which, you know, again, I was graced with their aiming it at me, so that's helpful. So
that actually is interesting in terms of the earlier panel, which Finola Cronin was on. You might remember her. She had danced with Pina Bausch for 10 years.
Yeah, I know who she is, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they were talking, and she and some other folks were talking about the body memory of, you know, working with one choreographer. And I would say that the people who work with you are very special, and they're not in every other person's company. They do other work, of course.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
You know, they're not just like for hired dancers, if that's a term.
No, a lot of them make their own work, and, you know, so yeah, it's amazing. And being in the room with that many people and not having to manage it in any psychological way, you know, it really was not problematic. There was no bad people there. So yeah, it was a really great experience. I really appreciate being able to see the piece again, because it brings that whole experience of making it back up as well, you know.
Right. The other thing that happens, though, I mean, I've seen this happen a lot since, you know, early 80s, like somebody like Trish Brown would have a company that was made up of her peers and friends. And then they would go away and she would get new dancers, and they would go away and she would get new dancers. And after a while, if Trish was on tour when she was alive, she wasn't having dinner with the dancers because they were all so much younger. Mm-hmm. And I think it's interesting that you've been able to mix generations and that doesn't get in the way, which is great.
No, I mean, I wouldn't be able to have a bunch of bright young things that I don't know, that I'll stop working if I have to do that. And all these people, even though some of them are young, you know, they're engaged in the world and they're really present, and I want to hang out with them. You know, I've had the great good fortune of being able to mentor a lot of young people. And, you know, you just get to this point where you're like, they're the leaders. I'm not. They're in the new place. I have something to hear from them, especially the more non-militant intellects who can deliver their message without a fight. It's very interesting to be around these people. And so that, I mean, even now I'm 63 and I teach at a grad program, and it's like, there's constantly saying things you're like, oh, well, that kind of just undoes my entire paradigm, but okay. But it's great. You know, it's wonderful. Cause you're like, you're in the middle of watching something evolve on Earth, you know, with people from all different backgrounds and all different sources of information. And, you know, so you can't sit back, nor do you want to. So, and I'm able to, I think in my next piece too, I'm able to really continue with that tradition of, you know, not casting, but being present with these people, you know, so.
Because I'm a fan, I'm just gonna say, shout out to Devin Emery's doing some amazing work of their own right now that I'm quite moved by.
Oh yeah, very much so, yeah.
So Terry, someone asks if you have any feeling of Irishness in your artistic identity. Are there any Irish artists or writers that you admire or identify with?
Oh, I do definitely. I mean, I feel the one thing I feel is that when I went to Ireland, thanks to Laurie in some cases, and Jean Butler, I was there for like 4 years in a row. Every year I was there. And I just remember that everyone there has a lot of words in their mouths and use them with great complexity. And, you know, and that is something that makes a lot of sense to me, actually in my choreography as well. A kind of just really florid kind of presentation of thoughts that have a lot of adjectives and corner turns and stuff. So I definitely feel that. And, you know, without getting in any way comparing myself, but something like Joyce's Undoing of Language is not, you know, that's definitely an inspiration to me in the way that I'm looking at, well, I mean, me and everybody else in modern literature, but you know, that definitely is something, this sense of very positive undoing of the language is definitely resonates with me. So yeah, when I say I don't really know, I just don't know. We just found out about our background a little bit more from some ancestry things people are doing. I don't know that so much because my parents and my grandparents are the kind of people who want, you know, they were made to hide their history when they got here. And they continued that with a shut mouth till the day that they died, you know. So that's kind of that. But yeah, but Ireland, every time I've been there, I felt like I feel comfortable here with this kind of garrulousness that the whole country has, you know.
Yes, that's a good point. Lisa McLaughlin has a question, and she wonders about your working outside of the good bad paradigm. And I would just add that you're vehemently against any kind of dichotomy that, you know, one or the other, black or white. So if you are working outside of that binary, what does dance do?
Mm-hmm. I'm going to tell you, like, if you can be at the hospital minutes before I die, I will reveal that to you. But now, I would say, no, it what it offers me is a really positive look at how to form ideas without constructing them in a with the desire for primacy of meaning, so that I'm not coming up with the best idea or a singular definition ever. And so that gives birth to a lot of hybridization right inside of what one is making. And it also gives value to a concept of tangent, which creates a different kind of product. So you can be going down many different hallways and never coming to a room. But, you know, again, that's an okay place for me. While you're in that hallway, a lot can be dislodged from your own memory as a viewer and brought forth in the piece. So I'm really looking at the kind of specificity of the kind of product that a dance can come up with, which is for me inimitable in my usage of it. I mean, other people are doing other things with dance where this may not pertain. There's so many kind of ways that people look at dance, but in my experience with it, it's the only place that can come up with a product like this. And, you know, a lot of times what I teach in my class, I'm going to teach for this, but one of the examples I use to say what I'm doing or what I'm thinking about is this idea that, you know, the structures that you can make in choreography don't need to be viable. Like, you can't make a cottage with an I-beam coming out of the roof with a skyscraper on top of it. But you could make an idea that's like that. So there's this kind of like very, very amplified future idealism in the work, a potentiality. And I think that's what it is. And also an offering of alternative logics. We're so addicted to what we think is the right way to go, including the way we speak, everything, walking down the street. I mean, right now I'm hearing it. If I hear one more person say the phrase 100%, I'm going to jump out the window. The way that language just becomes a part of people, and they haven't even selected it. And they start saying this thing that's just communal now, which is ostensibly a good thing. So I'm afraid of all those places where there's standardized human behavior. And this is a kind of a place where there's an alternative for me.
Well, I always love the way you talk about dance as a particular art form that really cannot barely be commodified for the most part. Unlike maybe theater or visual arts, which do have very commercial aspects. I mean, there's some commercial dance, of course, but much less. And that allows a kind of freedom, I think, to
Oh, absolutely.
to not worry about certain strictures, I guess I would say.
Yes. No, that's when I say like I really appreciate my experience, part of it is just learning that and what you're saying exactly. Like if you're in a Hollywood area and you're a guy who did this kind of film, that's the kind of guy you are. And you have to answer that to keep making your money, you know. I don't have anyone telling me what to do, you know, or I've never had a producer say like, well, I don't really like this or that ever. So, you know, that's pretty great for me to be able to continue doing this stuff. So,
Ella Clark wants to ask about the costume design. She noted that they're all completely autonomous, but there's still a coherence among them. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's thanks to my blessed friend, Walter Dunderville, who's been a friend of mine since 1980, you know, maybe 1880, I don't even remember. But he and I discussed that we both are, I mean, you may not be able to tell, but I'm very into fashion. I watch it a lot. I don't wear it, but, and so is he. So we just blabbed for hours to get to this place. And then he has in his own artwork, as well, his own choreography, he's really was working with draping, the idea of just like throwing something on a body and then pinning it. And that's where a lot of these came from, you know. And then we talked about each person and saying like, what are like 13 things they could be representing? And we would bring those together and say like, there's a cut like with, you know, Silas is like a go-go dancer king, construction worker, hostess, you know, so just, and then you just put these things together and they come out. But I mean, I really love the costumes for this piece, and I don't love the costumes for many of my pieces or anyone else's. They're usually just tragic, but these ones, I'm so happy with them. It's great to see them again as well, you know?
So with that in mind, was Heather in the green dress one particular thing as opposed to four or five different embodiments?
No, but Heather was a kind of, for me, abstract narrator. She just stood out. She introduces and then she enacts in a big way throughout the piece. So she has a different kind of presence. I mean, very little, but I just thought the way it should open would be this promise of color that isn't ever really fulfilled. I can't really remember how he generated that, but I really love that dress he made for her. I think it is so beautiful. It moves, and it moves so nicely for the first solo as well. But yeah,
that opening solo is extraordinary. I could watch that forever, I think.
I'm so happy. We worked so hard on that.
The way she bends and what follows never seems like expected at all from the thing before. It's just extraordinary. Yeah.
You, I appreciate it. That was really, really Heather's worked with me for 23 years now. And it was a really subtle work, just us by ourselves. And I wanted it to be really small but visible because, you know, we were going to be in some big theaters as well as BAM. And so I said, we have to make this, you know, register but not lose itself because it's got to be super subtle, you know. She's a genius at that. She's so great at it. As well as, I don't know if you remember, there's a trio later on where they kind of manhandle her / she's pulling them around, where I also think she's so double her presence in that. I love it.
Yeah, she's both vulnerable and weak and the powerful one.
And managing it somehow.
Yeah,
it's really nice. It's so nice. So.
You know, because this festival is called Dancer from the Dance, I wonder, because there are 11 extraordinary people and they kind of, the credits go by like that. Yes. You wanna say just a little bit about each of them? And we've talked about Heather, we've talked about Oisin.
Sure. Well, Silas.
Okay.
So Silas is like a dancer that maybe people have seen. He was in the last 6 years of the final Cunningham iteration. And he is an amazing dancer. And he's a very good friend also. And he's really like a person who knows everything that's going on. He could probably do anyone's part. but not in an annoying way, in a helpful way.
And he had his hair in a ponytail and had the brown drapey thing on.
Yes, he had the long, big brown thing and his hair in a ponytail, yeah. Handsome guy. And just a love, you know, like really, he's kind of like the unselected assistant. He takes on that role in a really good way, you know. And yeah, I love having him in the work and having him as a friend also. And then there is who? Devin. Devin is someone I've known since they were with Headlong, which is a company in Philadelphia, for people who don't know, who was pretty influential in the national scene for quite a while. And then I just kind of kept connected with Devin through various other things they were doing. And then just wanted to work with them because I mean, with Devin, there's like a family thing. I think a lot of people feel that with Devin. Devin, we connected early and solidly. And so that just made a lot of sense for me. Ryan Kelly is the guy with the curly hair who is an artist in his own right, together with Brennan Gerard, and who's making incredible things right now, lives in Paris. He's also making choreography for Solange right now, as well as working at Le Corbusier's for home in the south of France. I mean, they're doing really great stuff. Another huge intellect and really amazing guy who called me after I did a piece called Wrought Iron Fog and said, I'd like to talk to you. And I'm like, anyone who does that, I'm always like on board. And then he talked about, you know, everything he was seeing. It was so smart. He danced with New York City Ballet for a while, and then he's gone into like a complete immersion into queer visual arts. So he's another, like, these are the minds I'm dealing with there. Great, great person. Cynthia Oliver is my colleague here at the University of Illinois, and she is an amazing writer, teacher, theorist, and performer and choreographer. She makes her own work. I work very close with her here at the university. And, you know, she was amazing to work with because it's really hard to explain what she has. She's a very clear human being. There are no ethical mistakes in that person ever. And it's really wonderful to have her in the room. And then going with sister, there is also David Thompson, who I've known since definitely 1976 when I went to college. So we've known each other. He went to Purchase together. We went to Purchase together. And, you know, just been many, 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 many years of being in the same little ilk. And finally, it was time. I saw at Cynthia's 50th birthday, David and Cynthia were there. And we were all talking. I was like, we should do something together. And then we did. So.
And he's also doing really well. I think he just got a grant for something.
He's continuing to work, you know, at my age, and he's dancing. I'm not dancing anymore, but he's still dancing. So, yeah. And then who else is there? There's Michael Engel, who's been in like five works of mine. I just met him when he was pretty young, pretty taciturn guy, but has also been there for like, is it such a brilliant, silky, but bulky mover. And someone who, like in Poem, for example, which is the piece that we started one part of this project, there's a lot of petit allegro in it. And Michael has never taken a ballet class, but he does petit allegro with Heather and Silas, who both could, like, you know, do calligraphy using petit allegro. But so that idea of placing people in different forms without it being ironic, he has so much integrity in it, but saying like, what is this form if it's not about virtuosity, if it's about some other kind of expression or even difficulty or entanglement that a human being could have. So Michael really brought a lot to there. And also he's another one of those, I support the group people that are just brilliant to have around, you know.
And Natalie
Green, yeah, is just like a living bottle of perfume. I love her. She's so great. She has like such amazing sense of rhythm in her body. That's both the rhythm you're delivering and also one that's specific to her, and the blend of her her phrasing with the rhythms is really amazing. And her expression, she's really like ready to be the conduit for a whole range of feelings in it. And she brings those to the fore in times when it's not necessarily like asked for, but it's always measured and perfect what she's doing. So she's a really great person to greet in there. Tess Dworman, who is just a really amazing mover, like largely improvisational. And she's someone that was a student here, but has become a very good friend. And is making really interesting work now, I think. But at the dancing level, she's, you know, I mean, I don't think a lot of people have seen what she can do on Earth, but she's a master. No one has a better use of the range of subtle area, like 0 to 8.5% of the dynamic range going to 100.
100%.
100%. No, I didn't say percent. I said 100.
And she's in your next work, right? Maybe you want to talk a little bit about what's coming up then.
Yeah, she's in my next work. And my next work is going to kind of be in terms of talking about areas of choreography that are like communicative centers, in my opinion. One of them is this kind of exit from unison, the moment unison goes away. So I'm going to be really working with, in a piece called Rivulets, I'm going to be working with non-unison and trying to locate modes of expression there without it having anyone say the word chaos after it's over, hopefully. And I'm going to work with each of the dancers for 2 weeks alone for each of them. And I'm going to develop material with them, not looking to find any synchronicity between all of them. Then put all of that together and locate a mode for completing it. So I hope it works.
Right. Wow.
I'm going to work all individual material and then bring it into the room together and start to, you know, it's just a kind of extension of what I was talking about before, where, you know, you bring these things together and they suggest a governing principle. You don't bring one from outside. Mm-hmm. You have to locate it by the code. It's like having an urban planner go into a place that's been created over decades and layers and layers and layers. And like, well, what should I do? Tear it all down and put a grid, or include its complexity in this new design somehow, you know, or take information from it. So that's what I'm doing.
And that requires a lot of watching.
Absolutely.
Very carefully. Yeah.
And I did a little bit of version of this on some students here in a piece I'm making, the same concept where I worked individually and put it together. And it is really interesting to start choreographing qualitative things over visual synchronicity. And just to say like, oh, I can see this person in the back and this person are in a really kind of deflated mode. I can bring that to the attention of the viewer without saying like, do the exact same thing.
I think you did that in Frozen Mom.
To some degree, yeah. But that was much more calculated.
Okay. Interesting.
That was Frozen, you know, in a lot of the works that I make, that, you know, it's sometimes I make the movement, sometimes they make the movement, all evolves. In Frozen Mommy, I made every second of it myself for some reason.
Uh-huh. It's 14 hours.
Oops. It's time. Okay. It's time. Sorry. All right, well,
okay.
Sean, do we have 1 minute to wrap it up? Let Terry say something final.
Absolutely. Terry, Laurie, thank you. It's been amazing to hear about the process and the relationship to your other work. And it's been wonderful to virtually be able to show one of your large scale pieces for the first time in Ireland. And this is a direct follow on from the work Laurie did in Dublin Dance Festival, Round Earth and Jean's piece. And welcome back to Ireland.
Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate you bringing some light to the piece again. You know, we work so hard on these things and then they just get discarded. started. But, you know, I really appreciate that. And I hope that people enjoyed it. And thanks so much for having me talk as well.
It's a pleasure. And hopefully next time in person.
Definitely.
Budgets and pandemics permitting.
Got to come back there at some point. Definitely. So
it's a deal.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks Lori.
Terry.
Thanks, Terry.
And thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you, Terry. And thank you, Lori. And thank you, everyone, for staying with us and watching. And tomorrow, we have a Cunningham class in the morning through Dance Island with Anna Shirescu. And then in the afternoon, we have a workshop with Peggy Gould on symmetry, asymmetry.
Oh, wow.
And that's at 4 p.m. Irish time. It's available to anyone via the Dance Island website. And then we have at 6 o'clock, a beautiful film by Mary Wycherley and Joan Davis, In the Bell's Shadow, about Joan's amazing work process. And then at 7:30 Irish time, we have Gathering One, which is it's a mixed bill of choreography by a whole wonderful group of artists, including Yoshiko Chuma, Morgan Bullock, Raja Feather Kelly, Liam O'Scanlon, Sean Curran. We've got a really great list of people, and we'll see you all tomorrow. And thank you again, and good night.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.